तर त्या माई साहेबाचा बायोडाटा त्याच्यावर पाठवलाय मी मेलवर एनएसपीचा, त्याला प्रिंट काढायला.
हॅलो, गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
अरे गुड मॉर्निंग स्वाती, मी किती वेळा फोन लावून आलो, फोन नाही उठून आहे. हॅलो,
गुड मॉर्निंग काल पांडे.
हा गुड मॉर्निंग सर, व्हेरी गुड मॉर्निंग.
गुड मॉर्निंग. सो केव्हा सुरू करायचं आहे?
बस सर, 5-6 मिनिटं.
हे तुमचा कॅमेरा आहे ना इकडून?
मदत आहे कॅमेरा
नाही, हे काय आहे हा, त्याच्यामुळे आवाज स्पष्ट येतो ना. आमच्या तिथे घरी काय होतं की तो हे नाही होत तेवढं,
आणि तो कॅमेरा खूप चांगला
आहे. कॅमेरा चांगला आहे सर.
हॅलो, गुड मॉर्निंग सर.
गुड मॉर्निंग
सर. ऑलमोस्ट 210 पार्टिसिपंट हॅव जॉईन. सर, वी आर हॅव्हिंग अराउंड 1000+ पार्टिसिपंट फॉर दिस ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम. सो रिमेनिंग पार्टिसिपंट विल जॉईन अस सर इन बिटवीन. वी स्टार्ट दिस सेशन. गुड मॉर्निंग टू एव्हरीवन. Today is the last day of our training program. It is the 10th day of our training program. And we are very fortunate to have with us Dr. Siri Mai sir as an eminent speaker for the today's morning session. Dr. Siri Mai sir is the president of the board of directors of South Asia Biotechnology Center, New Delhi. He is also former chairman of the ASRB New Delhi and the former vice chancellor of the VNMKV Parbhani. So very warm welcome to you sir. And now I request Dr. S.R. Kaganda sir, PI of NHP Dr. PDKV Akola, to introduce Dr. C.D. Mai sir to the training participants.
So very good morning to all of you sir. Namaskar.
Namaskar. Namaskar.
All participants, training participants, today we are very fortunate that we have with us Dr. C.D. Mai sir. Dr. Siri Mai sir, we all know that he is the star in the galaxy of our agriculture. At present, Dr. Mai sir, he is the president, board of directors, SABC, New Delhi, and former chairman of ASRB, Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, ICR, New Delhi. And sir was former vice chancellor of Vasantrao Naik Marathwada Vishwavidyapeeth Parbhani in Maharashtra. So I welcome you sir. Sir is also serving as a vice president of National Academy. I wanted to go Agriculture Sciences, NAS, New Delhi. Sir obtained his agricultural degree from Maharashtra and PhD in specialization in plant pathology and epidemiology from the Indian Agriculture Research Institute, IARI, New Delhi. He commenced his career in plant pathology research at IARI and worked in various capacities in Central Rice Research Institute, CRRI Cuttack, then Punjab Agriculture University, PAU Ludhiana, Maharashtra Agriculture University, MAU Parbhani, for nearly more than 30 years. The research, teaching, and extension experience led him to work as a vice chancellor of, at a time the name was Marathwada Agriculture University, Parbhani. Now it is VNMKV, Parbhani. Director, Central Institute of Cotton Research, CICR, Nagpur, and Agriculture Commissioner, Government of India, New Delhi, before retiring as a Chairman of Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, Government of India. Though specializing in plant pathology, Dr. Mahi sir committed himself for the growth of Indian agriculture. In plant pathology, he guided 20 PhD and more than 38 MSc students. He write books and monograph and publish over 200 scientific publications in journal of repute and serve the cause through development of subject. During his scientific career, Dr. Meiser promoted the production technologies of cotton, groundnut, sunflower, oat cereals, and always remain active in sports, games, cultural activities, and helping students in placement. Once again, I welcome you, sir, and request you to start your presentation, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Kalbande. First of all, let me thank the organizers for inviting me to be very important function. I think it is the last day, what has been told to me. Because after my lecture, there is going to be a valedictory function. This is National Agriculture Human Entrepreneurship Development Program. I think NAHEP program.
Higher Education Project.
Higher Education Program. Very good. So I am happy that this educational program now is consonance with about the new agriculture education policy of the Government of India also now. So we have to look into agriculture as also a subject for this thing. And you have chosen a topic for me. It's very good that agriculture biotechnology, what are the challenges and what are the opportunities? I think it is a very, very good topic. So I will start with a little presentation where I would like to give an idea as to what are those challenges and what are the opportunities we have. I will just quote you in very simple words. Today, probably you may be knowing that amongst agriculture biotechnology, BT cotton is the only crop where we have allowed in the country as the genetically modified crops. Now, this modified crop, the moment it was started, you know how much investment it has gone into? Each probably private company has gone into. Kindly, I will request all of you to kindly mute your these things so that this will become easy for me to speak to you. So, the simple business of BT cotton alone today in the country is something like 3,500 crores. You can imagine that if suppose we had allowed the GM technology on a large number of crops, of which I will be talking to you, I think what would have been the scope of entrepreneurship development in the entire program. Now I will show you some few slides. I think we have to share the screen. Thank you. नाही आपल्याला हे करावं लागेल ना. ठीक आहे, मला असं वाटते आपल्याला ते याच्यातून काढावं लागेल ना. आपलं डेस्कटॉप काढावं लागेल ना.
हॅलो सर.
येस, जस्ट कमिंग.
ओके ओके सर, याला मिनिमाइज करू शकता सर तुम्ही? नो प्रॉब्लेम. आणि डायरेक्ट पीपीटी सर तुम्ही तुमच्या स्क्रीनवर स्टार्ट करू शकता.
ते बंद करा.
हां
आय थिंक आता हे आहे करायला पूर्ण. येस या, आर यू एबल टू हिअर नाव? ओके.
सो
या, नाव आय विल बी टॉकिंग अबाउट जीएम टेक्नॉलॉजी इन फ्युजन इन इंडियन ऍग्रिकल्चर अँड वॉट आर द अपॉर्च्युनिटीज अँड चॅलेंजेस दॅट वी हॅव. लेट अस लुक इन टू वॉट आर द स्ट्राइड्स इंडियन ऍग्रिकल्चर हॅज मेड सिन्स इंडिपेंडन्स. And you will be very surprised that when I was a student of Nagpur Agriculture College, there was what we call it as a food shortage. I used to stand in a queue for ration shop. Today, I think we have come down to what is called as a self-sufficiency. And not only self-sufficiency, we are exporting also. And if you see, now this is a little old figure again, 17, 18, 275 million tons. Today we have already crossed nearly 290 million tons, and this year there will be record. I think one of the most important part of all this game was the green revolution, and green revolution is again a subject of what we call it as genetic transformation. What we have done is in wheat and rice we have just incorporated few genes that could be rust resistance and that could be dwarf type, and that's how we have now what we call it as a green revolution period. But now over a period of time, the green revolution time is more than now 50-55 years, we have series of problems. Our farm holding has come down, marginal farmers are nearly 74%, and even the small farmers, if you put together, more than 85% are now small farmers. So the technology is what we are looking into. And the challenges that we have before the country, like population growth, we may be about something like 135 crores, or it is about 1.35 billion. We will be crossing China in very soon. Shrinking water resources, land resources, climate change, changing food habits. Our food habits now, particularly if you see now the corona, the pandemic situation, our food habits are also changing very fast. And then we have to now, acceptance of new technologies has been a problem. Particularly, older generations are not ready to accept. That's why I always say that why not youth come in agriculture? Because they are the one who can accept new technologies. Low investment, low pace in the total. And this is what we call it as, by 2050, there will be this population bomb. That means it will be about 170 billion. So we require, if we see what is India tomorrow, you will be surprised to see that we have only 4.2% of the world's water, 2.4% of the world area, and 125 million hectares we have irrigated, total area 125 million hectares cultivated, and 80 million hectares net, what we call it as irrigated area. So our cropping intensity by irrigation we have to increase. But the whole problem is now we have 65% people who are staying in the rural areas, and 38% population is now earning in livelihood in what we call it as in cities. So average land holding has come, and we expect by 50 the ratio will turn. People from urban to rural to urban will become 65-35, and man land ratio also will come down to 0.65 7 hectare per person. So this is the situation which we are likely to come. The as I said, the demand for food will change. People, the population will go on eating more of non-vegetarian also. There will be more of egg utilization, calorie requirement would change, food prices will change, and there will be a lot of social concerns which we have already seen observed. So now the basic issue is that we need to grow more food with less land, less water per person. So need for more protein food, need for more nutritious food. As we said that we have food security, we are now talking about nutritional security. And therefore, our entire shift in the change is, for example, I just given you an example of adoption of a new technology. You see, there is one line called as new sub one, which is developed in rice, which can grow rice in submerged conditions. It is developed at Philippines. And this is how the impact of your even climate change has nullified. So we have to have technologies which are now very different. But simultaneously with liberalization in the world, we are now growing food which has a lot of import dependency. For example, we are now importing vegetable oil to the tune of 75,000 crores. We say that we are Atmanirbhar. We are self-sufficient in agriculture. But on other side, you'll see the oil seed sector, which is now crying. We are importing nearly 15 million tons of oil, soya oil, canola, sunflower oil, palm oil, and that too, soya oil and also canola. They are all GM crops. Even we are eating what we call it as cotton, this cotton seed oil, which is also actually GM oil. We are also importing some of the fruits, particularly cashew nut, particularly these almonds. We are importing on a very large scale. And I think I will talk to you later. Just a minute. I will make this phone off. Okay. So we are now also we are growing import dependency. So this is the implications for this are the changes in demography, shift towards urbanization, higher income will lead to changes in dietary composition. With increased consumption of meat, dairy product, fish product, having higher water and footprints. So our shift will be now totally changed. And so by 2050, is it not alarming? The situation which we encountered in 1966 at the time of Green Revolution, or maybe White Revolution, or maybe Sugar Revolution, now is it not alarming? Because we have to see our population increasing, urbanization growing, our dietary shift changes shifting, climate changes occurring, all these issues. Will the present practices of agriculture meet the challenges of future needs? First question. Is it not inevitable to produce more food from less of land? That is important. Can new technologies, biotech, able to meet these expectations? Each agriculture revolution today is backed by technology. Let me say, without technology, no country has prospered. Without technology, no agriculture self-sufficiency has occurred. Hence, we'll have to keep faith in technology. Thus, the country needs adoption and infusion of what we call it as biotech crops, or what they are called as GM technologies, which has now undergone several serious changes in the newer world. Let me say you what is the relevance of agriculture biotechnology today. It is satisfying growing demand of quality food. Now we are talking about nutritious food. It is going to have quality demand. Improve stability of food security, nutritional securities. And the technologies will increase not only productivity and yields, they will use less land, less fertilizer, less water resources. And feedstocks for bio-based fuels also can be improved. There are several examples of this. So today there has been more relevance. What I say is, if we are not ready by 2020 today, after this corona pandemic, I think by 2050, our situation will be worse. I will talk you. You see how we have come this way after independence. First is Green Revolution, high yielding, semi-dwarf, open pollinated varieties of wheat and rice, and rice genes are used for this. What kind of genes? We have used RHT1, RHT2 in wheat to dwarfen them. We have also used TETEP genes in case of rice to dwarfen them. And we changed the L-type thing. When we were only 50 million tons at the time of independence, today we are talking about food self. Godowns are full. 285 to 290 million tons. This is our now food security. Now food means all cereals, millets plus pulses. We do not include oilseed in the food crop. Hybridization is another technology where we have revolutionized our vegetable cultivation, cotton cultivation, sorghum, millet. In dryland agriculture, they say revolution has occurred mainly because of hybridization. GMS and CMS line. In maize, we have single gene dwarf, single hybrids now in maize. So the technologies have really. Now, the third now continuum is coming biotechnology. We have traits of biotechnology in soybean, cotton, canola, potato. We have CRI genes, we have EPSPS genes, and now there is a new breeding technology, what we call it as CRISPR. So I always call it that agriculture technology continuum is occurring in this country. Now they are going to be what we call it as gene drive technology. It is not only genome, but it is the genes also can be what we call it as genome editing technology. Genome editing technology. I think we have gone much ahead, and maybe they may not require any kind of revolution. I will just show you how the continuum, experiencing how the revolutions we have done. For example, Green Revolution, Golden Revolution in fruits and vegetables, Blue Revolution in fish, Egg and Poultry Silver Revolution, and Milk Revolutions. We have encountered all these things just from traditional farming. We have come to mechanization, all revolutions, and now we are entering biotechnology. So technology convergence is a very important part of the current century. And therefore, we have to have genetically modified crops as one of the most important component of biotechnology. Again, let us not confuse that agriculture biotechnology doesn't mean only genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is part of that. We have fermentation technology. We have another tissue culture technology in fruit crops. So there are very diverse type of thing. And today you will see that the genetically engineered foods, of which we are very conscious in the country, we are very conservative about it, has been so common. You take, for example, corn throughout America, Argentina, Brazil, soybean throughout, 85% to 90% soybean today is GM. Canola in Canada, we are now having potato, cotton throughout world nearly now, brinjal, what not. So we are now ranging from so many other products. And there are now more diverse offerings to consumers and in terms of their quality issues. For example, in Canada, we have gene 1 and 2, where we have developed what we call it as innate potatoes. Today, you cut a potato and keep it for some time. There is an oxidation, what is called as a browning. You can see here in the figure. But if you introduce those genes, what we call it as innate potatoes, there will be no browning. Same thing is happening in apple. You can't keep apple and keep it for a longer time. You have to finish it. So Arctic apple. In Canada, there is Aqui Bounty now, salmons, fish. The production of fishes or the size of fish is growing. There is Costa Rica pink, what we call it as apple, can come, which can also provide a lot of more nutrition. Eggplant, Bangladesh. This is all our own technology of India, adopted by Bangladesh. Now it has crossed more than 5,000 hectares. This is a little old slide. We have lignin, low lignin alfalfa, which is very good for digestion for the animal. So you can have, by another few years, there are lots of things. Why we need GM technology? Because it provides exclusive solutions for viral diseases, for which we do not have any problem. Today, probably you know, for fighting corona, although we are trying our Ayurvedic and other medicines, ultimately we are all looking for vaccine. And the vaccine which has come in Russia is also being the different vaccine being tried in almost 100 laboratories. And some hybrid or some vaccine which is developed by Oxford University is a GM technology used hybrid. We are today, we have in the country used diabetes, this insulin. What is that insulin? Insulin is all produced by GM technology. And we know that viral disease, we cannot fight. Papaya ring spot, we cannot fight with tobacco spotted ring. We have several viruses for which there are no solutions, there are no chemicals. We'll have to go in for such tech. There are cryptic insects, for example, Lepidopteran insect. Today we talk about corn, fall armyworm, which has entered in 2018 in this country. Now it is damaging the entire maize crop. Within a year, it has spread from Karnataka, Tamil Nadu to Uttarakhand and Arunachal Pradesh and Gujarat. Can you imagine? Throughout country, now there is a serious problem. Even within our own Vidarbha, Buldhana area, which is very famous, Aurangabad, famous for maize, is all suffering because of incidents of this. So this salinity is another issue where we can tackle with the GM technology. Drought is another issue. I'll give you an example. Climate change issues, quality improvement. So you can imagine these are exclusive solutions can be provided by this technology. Now, what are the opportunities of GM tech in this country? I'll give you an example. BT cotton. This is the first transgenic in India. A successful GM technology, what we have witnessed. The yield of cotton, because I have been a cotton man, I worked as cotton at Marathwada Agriculture University and also as a director of Cotton Institute and also as agriculture commissioner to look after cotton. The cotton yield was stagnant for 15 years in this country. People were worried. Every year there was a huge hue and cry for prices. Barrier of stagnation removed by why it was? Simply because of the pest, American bollworm. And for that, we have changed the entire scenario. 15 consecutive years, area adoption rate, number of technologies continued to soar after 2002. In 2016, BT cotton area is 10.8 million hectares. Today, it has already crossed 11 million hectares. More than 8 million farmers today are planting BT cotton. Indian BT cotton represents an unprecedented 200-fold increase in the field. Today, the productivity is doubled. We were stagnant of something like what we call it as 300 kg lint per hectare. You can see the graph, wonderful graph. Till 2001, 2002, when we introduced BT cotton, there is a sudden jump which has occurred because of BT cotton. Now, people blame that because of BT cotton, now there is a pink bollworm. 20 years, we have a continuous increase yield. We have not followed the technology adoption as it was already directed. We have not used refugia. We have because we are getting yield, farmers did not worry. But now there are problems. But that can be mitigated. See, the issue is that you can't blame technology for that. It is 2002, 2018, we have encountered the first pink bollworm problem. And let us very clear that pink bollworm is a late season issue. And therefore, we have to have different management practices from the very beginning. Now, this is transformation. We were importing something like 25 lakh bales in this country. Today, we are exporting. Even in this corona period, we have exported 60 lakh bales to Bangladesh, Vietnam, Indonesia, Thailand. Now China we have a little problem with China. Otherwise, we were the great exporter to China. So we have exported cotton. Almost a stage has come that we exported 90 lakh bales once. Today, even in this period, 50 to 60 has become common because we are not able to consume something like 360 lakh bales in our own situation. So the entire situation has changed. Now, this is a story of BT cotton. Still, we are skeptic about BT technology. In fact, our scientists have done a wonderful job. They are competing with the world scientists and they are ready for commercialization with RR Flex cotton. You all know, probably you'll be reading paper that Shetkari Sangatna has illegally, whether it is approved or not approved, they have brought illegal RR Flex cotton, which is resistant to the herbicide tolerant cotton. Now, they say because we have labor problem, we want it, but it should be actually officially released. Unfortunately, there has been a delay and that is what is occurring. That once the delay, probably farmers will try to get into, if the technology is good, BT Brinjal. Last year, there was a big report in Haryana. Somebody grew BT Brinjal without any permission. He was arrested and all the sorts of drama has occurred. But BT Brinjal has become very popular. Now in Bangladesh, more than 50,000 hectares are under BT cotton, BT Brinjal. Less tobacco. I think our pathology science has started with late blighter potato, Phytophthora infestans. We have now developed late blight resistance potato at Shimla. Mustard hybrids, Delhi University technology for developing mustard hybrid. Now it is a technology, GM technology used, Barnett Barstar, for developing mustard hybrids. Protein quality potato, golden rice, one of the most important part is vitamin A, which is a technology which is free of all patents. Pod borer resistant chickpea has been developed by Assam Agriculture University. And nitrogen use efficiency in rice. You can control urea use, nitrogen use. High iron rice, salt tolerant rice. Technologies are independent. We have large number of them. And we can have even soybean, we can have even maize. Now for fall armyworm, I think the best technology would be BT maize. But we are yet to start this thing. This is what is that fruit and shoot borer transgenic BT Brinjal, which was developed by Mexico and using the EE1, Cryvon AC gene, which is commercialized in Bangladesh. Now, NRC biotechnology has also developed. It is not only private. Even the other companies, NRC biotechnology, this year they are permitted to have trials to be conducted. Even IIVR Varanasi has also developed BT Brinjal. So we have people who are developing. This is what is Kufri Jyoti. You can see the lines which are not killed by Phytophthora. Wonderful technology. Protein quality potato. Potatoes are eaten for starch and carbohydrates. But now we have seed albumin amaranthus, which has been balanced amino acid composition. So those who are only potato eaters can also manage it. Now brown plant hopper resistance in snowdrop lectin. This is in rice, very useful. And salt tolerant rice. Expression has already been shown in, and the genes are used for mangrove plant. Even Swaminathan's foundation is working on salt tolerant rice. Contained field trials are already going on in Chennai. Expression in Pusa Basmati. And there is a huge tolerance limit of 100 micromolar of sodium chloride. Now this is pod borer resistant chickpea. I already said that chickpea and pigeon pea, the major problem is again Lepidopteran pest. And these pod borers, Helicoverpa, is very damaging. So if it can be controlled in cotton, why not it is to be done? But then these crops are leguminous. They are more difficult to be really amenable for tissue culture. Indian mustard, Delhi University campus used Barnett Barstar technology and developed male sterility restorer system, which has been used. All trials are complete. Even there was a stage that it was recommended. However, the political decision is yet to be completed and therefore it is there. So, this is what is mustard study. After painstaking decade research, Dr. Deepak Pental has actually gone, GAC has been pending approval for field planting. Noticeably, GM canola account for 104 million tons, 94% of the global trade. I already told you, that in spite of the fact that we are importing cooking oil to the tune of 15 million tons, this is what is the situation. We are importing GM soya, soya oil, also soybeans, canola GM. We are importing also, we are eating cotton. So there are large number of areas, even GM groundnut is being developed in India. So we have lots of opportunities in all these things. And in spite of that, now there is, I will just divert you, that what is important today is nutritional security. Our India, they say vitamin A deficiency, nearly 2,50,000 to 5,00,000 vitamin A deficiency children become blind every year. This is the report of WHO. Half of them die a year losing sight. Even the tragedy is with the pregnant woman. Can be eliminated. This tragedy can be eliminated by simply growing nutritious food. Now, who estimates these things? Golden rice, which was developed in Switzerland, and the expression of enzyme of beta carotene. This is the pathway of rice endosperm, and this is an amelioration of vitamin. This becomes yellow rice. It's a very wonderful technology which has been really popular. And this golden rice technology is what we call it as pro-vitamin A carotide levels have been so high, 36.7 millimicron. So this is a very important technology which was developed again by Syngenta and was being given free. And the person who started is called as Ingo Porticus. One of our famous, I personally met him. We are having a lot of good dialogue in Delhi. And he was so weeping practically. He says, this can save India's poor population. Those who are rice eaters can develop it. And we have already done Indian rice lines with 8 to 25 micrograms of rice produced by breeding. Lines with 16 micrograms of rice are enough to meet 50% of your deficiencies. Modern rich, high-yielding indica rice cultivars can be. So, you can see our nutritional state, beta-carotene in rich rice. Similarly, the DBT-sponsored Chandigarh Institute, they have developed also what is called as vitamin A, that is yellow bananas. Very important. Now, there are Visarium milled Sigatoka enriched bananas, carotene rich banana, B carotene rich bananas. We have insect resistance almost all crops. Cowpea, BT cowpea has been released in many African, Nigeria. So delayed ripening, drought tolerant yield, less gluten in wheat and jawar. All these are the different traits which we can. I will just give you the maize, for example. So many traits are now available in maize. You can see transgenic rice. So many traits have been already. It is not only one. It may not be Bayer alone. It may not be DuPont alone. But we have our private companies in India as well as our Department of Botany, University of Calcutta, TNAU Coimbatore. They are also involved in all kinds of research. Now, abiotic stress tolerant transgenics, very interesting, because abiotic stress tolerance is mainly drought and salinity. Dehydration and salt tolerance, there are now issues in rice, mulberry, tomato, brinjal, sorghum, banana. So, huge number of, I have just given you sources, all of them, they belong to Indian situation. Mahanti's paper, Mallikarjun's paper, Goyal's paper, Maheshwari. You can imagine what kind of research our own people are being doing. Virus-resistant transgenic crops, Praveen, Amudha at CICR, Chakrabarti at BRC Bombay, Lata. You can see Osmania University, lots of gene coding in almost tobacco, cotton, tobacco, finger millet. So we have virus-resistant material also being getting ready. Resistance to fungal diseases, is another very important part. I will not go into very big details because there are so many other problems. I will just take example of cotton. See, cotton lines expressing NPR1 genes. Very interesting. Now here is the resistance to Fusarium oxysporum. Fusarium oxysporum is a serious problem in our desi cottons. And Verticillium dahlii is a serious problem in American cotton. So both of them, you can see, can be managed by using certain gene expression. Cotton quality improvement. I think ultra-low gossypol cotton lines, which are developed by our own scientist in America, Kirti Rathod, in Texas, A&M. This low gossypol cotton has been released now. Very wonderful. That the gossypol, which is a very detrimental product in the seed, because we have to remove gossypol if we want to take seed oil. He has developed a technology in such a way that the gossypol will remain in bracts, it will remain in foliage, it will remain in stem, but it will not remain in seed. And this is wonderful technology. That's why American government, USDA, has already permitted this planting of gossypol freeze technology. We have also CRISPR-9 technology for insect control. For example, nematodes. Very serious problem, not only in cotton, vegetables, and so many things. Now, a lot of work has been being done that these reniform nematodes, particularly Rotelenchus, can be very well controlled by using what we call it as RNAi technology. And for that, there has been wonderful work which is going on. Similarly, we have also technology for drought. Osmotic overexpression and drought tolerance. You can see this, the other plant, 6163, which is on my left side, maybe it is on your right side, they are having those genes where they can tolerate water stress. And I think in India, what is important for us is our water stress issue. Now, for example, vitamin A banana. These are the trials which have been. Are you able to hear? Are you able to hear? Vijay yes, Kumar? Sir. Yeah, okay. Because there is no line now here. Vitamin A banana. Now, quality traits. There are a lot of quality traits which are very important. Increased vitamin A content, omega-3 content, reduced acrylamide content, increased oleic acid content, non-browning apples, which I already said, told to you. So, biofortification is another area which has been done for zinc biofortification, vitamin A biofortification. So, these are all success stories, and this is very important because now there are opportunities which are coming. ICAR has released zinc and iron rich bajra, zinc and iron rich wheat, and so many other which are varieties rich anthocyanin pigments. So you can see there is a potential now for all these areas of biofortification also, where ICAR is now releasing a lot of nutritional security material. Now there is a big potential therefore for the new breeding technology. We have traditional breeding, we have mutation breeding, we have hybridization, we have now biotechnology, GM crops, now we have CRISPR, talons, zinc finger nucleases, now it has lots of what we call it as precision, regulation, speed, cost, and genome edited crops. So you can imagine that biotech products are being developed now with new breeding technology. There will be no black spot in potato, and northern blight resistance already created in maize, reduced lignin content, high oil content also can be easy. Non-browning mushrooms, altered starch composition of maize. So these are all the new areas which are very important. But now I come to your GM infusion challenges. We have challenges of political and politics, social and ethical, financial and funding agencies, regulatory and legal, research and technology development challenges, consumer versus farmer debate, and biotech industry and IPR issues. there are lots of issues which are now, because there are funding agents. See, GM crops also can give tremendous opportunities to businesses. So it is not only science, but it is the art and now the commerce, which is creating a lot of problems. And the stakeholders which are involved are all mixed. There is funding agencies, regulation, government, universities, agriculture, biotech companies. There are interlinkages and dynamics cooperation also is an issue. But this we have to have. Interlinkage and dynamic cooperation is very important for the proof of concept. It has to start with that. And those who are interested in these crops, I think they must really do things. I would now come to the almost near the end of my talk, because now there is no line here. I thought that I should not extend, because otherwise it will stop in between. BT cotton brought prosperity to all. Then it has its own fallout, because one has money to play. A lot of fighting going on. In poverty, we unite, but in prosperity, we divide. Typical Indian syndrome with several examples. First fallout is the maximum sale price fixed of cotton, but not other costly needs. The moment government entered into fixing of cotton price, I think a lot of illegal players have come into picture. Second is the draft guidelines which is prepared by government, which is also illogical. And third is the government arbitration. When brothers fight, we always like it to share the richness with lawyers. We spend a lot of money. Lots of cases are in court. Fourth is allow court interventions in science. Should we allow court interventions for in all this science? I think my last, therefore, slide is that there is wide scope in the entire scenario of what we call it as biotechnology. I have very quickly, because after a few slides, I could not really explain to you. But let me tell you that the entire field of biotechnology, I am only talked about more of genes, gene-related, CRISPR technology. This is growing very fast and it can solve large number of problems. Now, there are people who are now contradicting. They say, on one side, we are talking about organic. On the other side, we are talking about zero budget farming. We don't mind. See, there is nothing wrong. My point is that no single method of agriculture adoption can be universal for the country. You can't have the same technology which is being grown in Sikkim to have it in Kerala. We have so many, 120 what we call it as agroecological zones in this country. They need different kinds of technology. If somebody can follow, okay, they need something like organic farming, it can be. But then organic farming has to have proper methods. The technology has to be properly developed and used. Zero budget, I don't mind. But you'll have to understand the entire perspective of it and then follow it. So, I am not against any technology. I am for GM technology, perfectly okay. Because I know that there are some intractable problems in this country, which our farmers are not able to really solve them. And therefore, I thought it is the opportunity for you to really see that this... I think thank you very much. I will start my video. Apna video puna start karte hain. So that those who have any, yeah, correct. Line gili ka? Applicate problems. So thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. It was very informative lecture delivered by you. Now we will move toward question and answer session. I request all the participants to ask the question or they can write in chat box or they may raise their hand to interact with sir. Now I request Suresh Tamira sir, please ask your question. I have unmuted you.
Good morning, Dr. Mahi sir.
Good morning.
Yeah, I feel it's a privilege for me to talk to you and see you. Actually, I have a quick question. So, is there any BT development is happening in dragon fruit, doctor? Actually, because nowadays in India.
But is there any problem in dragon fruit? I don't know because it is such a small crop at present. We have no technology being developed for dragon fruit.
Yeah, actually, we are getting all the technologies from other countries and other journals. But right now in India, we don't have anything dragon fruit, but slowly it is growing up. So do we have any mechanism for going forward? Are we going to start any separate vertical for this dragon fruit development, doctor?
There are some states where they are attempting these verticals to start, like in Chhattisgarh. I find that there is a big scope and they are being developed. But I don't find that dragon fruit universally in India is getting accepted more. But slowly it will pick up now.
Okay, because we are doing it in Imphal, doctor. Actually, Manipur, we are doing it.
It's a good. It's a good thing. Yeah.
So, but I feel some little insecticides, pesticides, something we are facing some problem. So if in India, if anybody is doing any particular scientist,
let me tell you. At present, there is some information from Chhattisgarh, but I would request you to kindly find out what are the issues of either disease or pest or salinity or other growth problems. I think then we can really work on that.
Yeah, only size problem we are facing, doctor, right now.
Okay. It can be taken up, yeah.
Okay, thank you, doctor.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Rajesh Pal, sir. Please ask your question. I have unmuted you. Dr. Rajesh Pal, sir.
Rajesh Pal.
Dr. Prashant, sir, I have unmuted you. Please unmute by your side.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
This is Prashant Shingode, sir, from PDKV Akola.
Okay.
I have one query, sir, that BG3 technologies used in other countries. So, is there any chance that because we are facing the problem of pink bollworm right now? So, for that, is there any chance that our government would allow such technology?
Let me tell you very frankly that the BG3 technology, what they talk is that BG, that is BT1, BT2, and now they are talking about this technology is also called as BG3, where we are using HT. But for BT, there is a WIP gene which is being used. But let me tell you, that for pink bollworm, there is no proper gene available at present. And it is not that easily be controllable because the pest occurs at a very later stage. And there is a tremendous dilution in the protein level. That's why we are not able to control pink bollworm. But pink bollworm management, which we have already successfully done through extension methodologies, that means we teach the farmers not to have a plantation which is done in summer, avoid it. Simultaneous planting, community planting, which is very helpful. And then we use at least up till 100 days, we should be able to use all pheromone traps. So it is not necessarily that every time we should go in for only biotechnological means. So there, it has to be integrated in a proper manner.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Sangana Bhavsa Golai.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning.
Sir, this is Dr. Golagi from Horticulture University, Bagalkot, from Karnataka.
Very good, huh?
Sir, in our EVS Dharwad, some biotechnological crops have developed. But the thing is, in cotton, there is some problem with that you already mentioned with respect to the cotton and other things.
Yeah.
Whether the scientists have to take up this biotechnological work or not? The government,
biotechnological work, nobody has stopped. Biotechnological work will go on because it is yet time that we have yet to decide a final policy for releasing of them. Let us forget about it. I think I have already shown you that Delhi University, Tamil Nadu Agriculture University, even your Dharwad University, even many other institutions at Hyderabad, IRI, IVRI, they are all working on the problem. Even Shimla, our potato institute, See, they have not stopped work. They will prepare the product. The product, whether to be brought in the market, will all depend on the, like what Dr. Deepak Pentel's mustard. It will all depend on the policy issue. But over a period of time, I think the government of India will realize if it is an important thing, they will slowly, because now they are talking about oilseed. And they realize that we need to improve oilseed crops. Like soybean, for example, we need BT and HT soybean to improve its productivity. Otherwise, our productivity is only 1/3 of Argentina, Brazil, and America. So those issues are now getting realized if we want to have Atmanirbharta. Okay?
Yes, sir. Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Sir, there are some questions in chat box. One of the questions is, sir, why Indian government is not allowing use of GM crops?
Yeah. Indian government is basically is not allowing. It is not allowing in the question. They are now still debating, I would say. Because there is a huge lobby which with activists, they feel that environmental problems, they feel it will be more aggravated. In spite of the convincing that it is not going to happen. But still, because of some rigid ideas of the old people, they are not ready to accept. And the government feels that let there will be a balance. Let the other people, everybody realize. And then they are asking all biotechnologists to convince those who are not biotechnologists or those who are opposing the technology to convince them that yes, the technology is useful. And I think that job is being done in the country at many forums. And I'm sure that government of India one day will realize. Today they have for the first time approved some trials of BT Brinjal. Now slowly I think they will come up with this. And now there is a biotechnology bill which is pending. So maybe once they change, like what they have seed bill, pesticide bill, biotechnology bill also will be put into the cabinet and in the parliament. And maybe I think we will have some changes in that so that it can have a balance to all those things. Any other question?
Okay, thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Another question is, sir, we use a number of chemicals like agarose in biotech labs and we are having manufacturing of these chemicals in India or completely we have to depend upon import?
For the time being, we have to depend on import. Although we are partially producing, but our requirement is very huge and therefore we are not able to complete required. Let me tell you, after this pandemic and after we have realized that we have to be self-sufficient in many things, particularly when we are importing from China and other countries, now we have to see that we may not be able to totally stop the import, but at least we should be able to have some standing of our own in every product that we produce. And that is how I think our entire policy is getting now transformed. So I'm sure that another 10 years, we will see India in a different mode. Our economy will totally be altered. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Sir, one of the question is, stem rot of groundnut, GM resistant variety is developed or not?
Yes. There are some very good source material. Even myself, I have worked on the Sclerotia rolfsi and Macrophobina fasciolona, where we have now varieties which are resistant to aflatoxin. We have varieties, but they are now being incorporated into the better elite lines in ICRISAT. I have seen a lot of work. Those who are interested can go to the website of ICRISAT and they will find that a lot of good work being done there. And also our grounded institute in Junagadh. Okay?
Okay, thank you, sir. Sir,
thank you.
Request, Dr. G.R. Bansal, sir. I am going to unmute you, sir. You have posted question on chat box, but I am not able to get it.
Any other question?
Yes, sir. Bansal, sir, I have unmuted you. You have to unmute from your side. Sir, till then, we will take another question. One of the question is, trichoderma gene can be transferred in plant?
Yes. There are attempts going on in Israel. There are attempts going on in Israel. Kindly mute. There are attempts going on in Israel where we are now trying to see that trichoderma, being one of our very important biotech biocontrol agent, can we transfer some of those genes? They are not directly, it cannot be like BT, because it's a trichoderma is a fungus and it has a, it's a multi cellular organism, and we have lots of other things with it. So the entire technology is different, but attempts are being made. Now, why not from trichoderma, even from pseudomonas, attempts are being made. So there are lots of chances. Once we discover microbes in a full way, that's why microbiology is now taking a very big stand, because they are the one which is understand. Even some of those microbes can now you be used for destroying this straw material, or converting straw material into ashes, where people are now burning in Punjab, Haryana, rice straw, wheat straw. So technologies, microbiology is now taking a big shape. So I am sure there will be lots of other activities, and it will be complementary. Biocontrol agents and biotechnology will be sort of complementary. Any other
thank
thing?
Thank you, sir. Sir, one of the question is, you have lot of experience in cotton. Any practical solution on para wilt of cotton?
Yeah, this is all my own work. I worked extensively on para wilt. Para wilt is a, I would say it's a complex problem. Those people where there has been a lot of dry period followed by very heavy rains, you get para wilt problem. So I would suggest them that immediately when there is a more dry period, they should have some kind of intercultivation operation. Soil should be loosened up so that it doesn't fall. And then if at all it is there, I think copper oxychloride, and there are some other insecticides which can be sprayed for time being. But it will be a sort of a very temporary relief. That is what I say.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, can we use GM technology for developing GM soil microflora to improve soil fertility?
We basically, there are lots of attempts being made that the GM microbes are being developed. Finally, but can we add those to soil to improve soil structure is a very long drawn question. I don't think at this stage we can discuss it. But there would be now microbes which would be genetically important. For example, if we have rhizobium, which is also genetically modified and can fix up nitrogen much faster, azotobacter, or maybe we have azospirillum, or maybe azolla. So we could change their capacity to really fix up nitrogen or other activities. That is how it is possible. But we add those genetically modified microflora in soil to improve will be a little difficult. I would say that it's a future something imagination.
Okay, thank you, sir. One of the question is, in order to promote biopesticides in eco-friendly pest management, why it is getting difficult from CIBRC Faridabad for mass production at state agriculture universities or research station?
I am sitting right in the College of Agriculture here, who are producing large amount of biopesticides and who are also biofertilizer. See, the issue is that there are, though we made a lot of simplification CIBRC, there is what we need to have a separate kind of organization along with CIBRC to register biopesticide. Now, probably you have also realized that government has made compulsory that if you are purchasing urea, you must also purchase biofertilizer. I think it's a good move, because then only it will be, you see, sort of complementary, and it will increase the nutrient. Similarly, if you are taking some chemical pesticide, it should be mandatory to use biopesticide also. I think these things are, but registration has still been a difficult problem because they need to have some every understanding of toxicity, chemistry, labeling and everything. So for that, CIBRC has not yet been equipped because there are very less manpower there. Otherwise, what I feel is that every institution should send their material and should get it. But because the cost involved is very high, it is becoming difficult. So that should be an approach to the government. Some organizations like state government of Maharashtra should really do it, or state of Madhya Pradesh should do it. On their own, government should go ahead with the university material and get it registered. I think that is the only solution.
Thank you, sir. Another question is there any loss in nutritive value of GMO food and non-GMO food?
Absolutely not. This has already been tested all over the world. There has been no, even they say that organic food is better, but nutritionally there has not been any difference between the food produced by zero budget, the organic budget or anything. It is only a matter of your test. Nutritionally, they are all equal.
Okay, thank you, sir. One of the question is there loss of any biodiversity by GMO crop?
There are, GMOs are governed by so many laws. It is not only the biodiversity law. Biodiversity law means it is the law where we cannot bring all of a sudden without permission any seed or gene material from outside unless it is permitted. The second thing is biodiversity laws applies to an area. Suppose I want to convert some plant material, I have to seek their permission so that indigenous material is not affected. So there are laws which will affect GM technology, and those who are working on GM technology are aware that it is not only the Environmental Act but several other acts they are to follow so that they are able to produce. Okay.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question is, what is the status of GM rice in India?
Actually, golden rice has been converted into Indian lines. But unfortunately, they are still under testing situation. There is not permitted as yet. But this is possible that we have golden rice. There is another technology what is coming up is what nitrogen use efficiency in rice, where rice is consuming a lot of nitrogen. So that technology is also coming. The other issue is possibly in rice technology is the brown plant hopper technology. That also can really come up. But the most important part is today's basmati rice, which is also basically developed because of molecular breeding. Is another technology of biotechnology. I did not talk about molecular breeding today because I thought that I will concentrate only on GM. But this, what Pusa Basmati is today, is all basically done by IARI, and it is all done by Dr. A.K. Singh's work, which has really given pathway to large, heavy production of Basmati, and now we are exporting Basmati on very large scale. So this is where we have used what we call it as X genes, these molecular markers for the resistance to bacterial blight, and now we are also trying for a blast. So there is a possibility of molecular breeding against those diseases.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question is, will it be possible to explore GM technology for fodder production?
Absolutely, it is just possible that we can improve. As I said, we have now alfalfa, which I already shown you, we have very low lignin alfalfa, which is digestible by the animal. So likewise, there could be lot of other activities where we can. It can be used in forestry, like China has done it in poplar. So poplar can grow very fast as the avenue. And also it is used for wood. So I would say that floriculture, then many crops of horticulture, and what you said about fodder, I think the technology can go very fast. Depending on what type of problem, it cannot be universal. You have to see that there is a problem which is intractable, which cannot be solved by other means. Now then we use the GM technology.
Okay, Thank you, sir. Another question is there any solution for weed control through bio-based weed control?
Bio-based weed control is which is being practiced by many farmers, where they are they are growing intercrops, and this intercrops will suppress them. This is called bio-based. But what farmers are interested in is using glyphosate again, because in cotton, for example, if they spray glyphosate and that even falls on cotton, it will not die if it has that genes of HT. So likewise, the technology. But bio-based, I think what is needed is we need a lot of labor for that. We need a lot of things where we can grow all intercrops and suppress the weeds.
Thank you, sir. Another question is, what are the problems related to BT3?
The problem related to BT seed are, number one, that we must see that the registered seed companies are allowed to sell BT cotton. There are a lot of companies who are not registered and whose products are not. Then we should also have tested BTs in the system, and then only it should be allowed. Today we have hundreds of them which are in the market, and I think that is one reason why we are getting pink bollworm. That is one reason why we are not getting optimum yields as we used to get it earlier. So there are some standard 20-25 companies who have their own research programs. I think they should be permitted to really sell BT's cotton seed.
Thank you, sir. One of our participants has posted a statement in chat box that, like insecticide, continuous use of GM crop also cause serious health problem in future.
See, one thing is that there, what kind of a threat? See, the issue is GM crops will spare you more insecticides. Today in cotton, if we were giving something like 30 sprays, today it has come down to 4. That means you are trying to see that GM crops are saving your use of sprays. So, and I don't think there is any otherwise harm, because they are permitted after testing all kinds. It is like drugs. We have several systems where we allow drugs after lots of investigation and lots of other toxicological, the chemical and other tests, then only allergenic tests, and then only it is permitted. So the issue is that it is a long-term benefit can be accrued by GM crops.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question is, can we do genetic variation in rice straw to change its quality, like reduction in silica content?
It is possible. It is possible.
Okay. Another question is, how many work by GM technology in poultry sector?
Poultry sector, as yet, we do not have much technology available. But it is possible, because in animal sector, there is a lot of research going on. So poultry also a lot of research going on.
Okay, sir. Another question is GM research and development in fruit crop is available in India?
It is in papaya. Is available. They are trying it in papaya, citrus. There are issues, but not in many crop, because it's a long duration crop. There are problems.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir has again raised his hand. Sir, I have unmuted you. Please ask your question.
Good morning once again, doctor. So in northeastern states, the Assam, majorly in that, from that belt onwards, the black rice they have started cultivating, doctor, actually. So is it the approved one from Indian scientists, or how is that actually? And how is that difference from the golden rice?
See, golden rice is totally different. Golden rice is genetically modified to introduce vitamin A resistance, vitamin A deficiency matter. We have already have those genes which will produce vitamin A there. But in case of black rice, it is a naturally grown rice. There are many black rice, even there are some red rices. They are naturally available in northeast and many areas. Now India, because there is a demand, and black rice is more what we call it as a sticky rice, which has a lot of starch in it. India, there is a lot of demand outside for black rice. So India is already, I think, exporting in small quantities of black rice. But that one and genetically modified is totally different. They are naturally available, black rice.
Okay, thank you.
So, madam, thank you very much.
Hello, sir. Good morning. I just want to ask a question.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is related to the black seed being generated by Nabi. But that has not been, approved by any agencies, competent agencies. Is it good to take that wheat for the consumption? Because that black wheat is being, I think, now sown in the area of Punjab somewhere.
No, I could not understand your question. What is the question? Can you repeat?
Question is that there's a black wheat.
Yeah, black wheat.
Wheat grains are developed by Nabi in Punjab. That has not been approved by competent agency in India. So is it worth to take this for the consumption?
Yes. Now, it is actually. I have myself consumed this black wheat. This is already what we call it as biofortified wheat, which is developed by Nabi in Chandigarh, and I think they are now trying that some companies take up for multiplication. I think that would be a very good rice where there is lot of Punjab has a lot of problem of zinc deficiency because of the normal wheat. So it's a very good for eating. No, absolutely no problem. I have even taken the atta of black wheat and made a chapati out of it. Very good. No problem.
Okay, sir. So now one more question is there. It is difficult to the transfer gene interspecific, intergenic than interspecific.
Difficult to transfer?
Hello.
Yes.
Intergeneric than interspecific.
No, again, your voice is little getting.
Intergeneric between the two.
It is possible. It is possible. There is that is called a cisgenic. Cisgenic.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Jagdish, sir. Please ask your question.
Hello.
Haan, sir. Sir, good morning. Myself Jahagirdar from VNMP Parbhani.
Haan, bola Jahagirdar.
Sir, kind of sir. Bhakta, my ikat mali ichcha hai ki, is there any possibility in the future years for the BT version in chickpea, pigeon pea or any edible crops?
आपल्या एडिबल क्रॉप मध्ये आता सध्या तर ब्रिंजल इज रेडी. वी हॅव ऑल्सो मस्टर्ड इज रेडी, एडिबलच आहे. देन वी हॅव चिकपी विच इज ऑलरेडी डन बाय आसाम ऍग्रिकल्चर युनिव्हर्सिटी अँड ट्रायल्स वी आर डन बाय मेहिको ऑल्सो. सो बट पिजन पी इट इज व्हेरी डिफिकल्ट ऍट प्रेझेंट टू रिअली ट्रान्सफर द जीन, बट इट इज पॉसिबल अँड दॅट इज अ व्हेरी गुड सोल्युशन इफ वी कुड डू इट. सो पीपल शुड वर्क ऑन दीज थिंग्स.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Shall I take some questions in chat box?
But what time is your valedictory, madam?
Sir, valedictory will start on 11:30 onwards.
Yeah, it is already 11:30 now. 30. Where is Kalbande?
Okay. Okay, sir. Now we will move to our end of the morning session. I am Ms. Sejal, Junior Research Fellow of NAHEP team. It's my proud privilege to propose vote of thanks to you, sir. Dr. C.D. Mai sir has delivered lecture on agricultural biotechnology challenges and opportunities in entrepreneurship development. Sir has explained different challenges and opportunities in agriculture biotechnology sector. Sir has discussed about genetically modified crops, biofortification research, biofortified foods. Also, sir has given potential of new breeding technologies. Sir has explained GM technology infusion in Indian agriculture, its challenges and opportunity. Sir has also explained interlinkage and dynamic cooperation. Sir has given lot of information regarding agricultural biotechnology sector and what are the opportunities in entrepreneurship development. Overall, it was very informative session and all the participants have enjoyed and have given very good feedback in the chat box for your lecture. On the behalf of NAGP team, I am very much thankful to you, sir. Thank you so much. Last but not least, I am also thankful to all the participants for joining with us and listen lecture of Mai sir very carefully and being interactive in the session. Thank you, all of you. We will start our valedictory function in couple of minutes as our all the dignitaries will join the meeting. Yes, valedictory function is continued with the same ID and password. You have to just stay in the meeting. It will start soon.
Hello, Mai sir.
Mute,
हेलो
हेलो
बोला
हेलो सर
बोला
तू बोल काय तरी मला येत नाही ना
हेलो सर वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट इन 5 मिनट्स ओके
बदल एवढं तुझी कळलं रत्नाकर बँक मोरले मी ऑलरेडी हो आहे पण तू मला एक सायमल्टेनियसली
हॅलो शाहू,
हॅलो सर, हॅलो जमले का? तिकडे हॅलो,
गुड मॉर्निंग सर, येत आहे? युअर व्हॉइस इज व्हेरी विजिबल सर,
ऑडिबल
सर.
कैरी ऑन माय सर जॉइन झाले
यस सर माय सर इज देयर
ओके स्वाती यू कैन स्टार्ट
यस सर थैंक यू सर वेलकम एंड गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट हियर dignitaries of the today's event faculty members NHEP team and all the trainee participants I am Ms. Swati and I take this privilege to warmly welcome you all on behalf of the National Agricultural Higher Education Project Dr. Panjab Rao Deshmukh Krishi Vidyapeeth Akola to the valedictory ceremony of the 2-week national e-training on Indian agriculture education system and entrepreneurship scope in 21st century organized during August 5 to 20 2020. It's good to see you all happy and very excited about this event. To welcome is to show honor. To welcome is to establish integrity. Ladies and gentlemen, we are delighted to have with us Honorable Dr. V.M. Bhale sir, Vice Chancellor of Dr. Panjab Rao Deshmukh Krishi Vidyapeeth Akola as a chairperson of the today's function. I welcome you, sir, to this auspicious event. We are truly honored and privileged to have with us Dr. C.D. Mai sir as the chief guest of the today's event. I am profusely elated to take this opportunity to introduce our chief guest, Dr. C.D. Mai sir, to the audience. Dr. C.D. Mai sir is a renowned scientist in the field of agriculture, born in 1946 at Sakharkheda village of Buldhana district in Maharashtra. Dr. Mai sir is currently engaged as adjunct professor at IRI New Delhi, Chairman of the Agriculture Finance Corporation, Mumbai, Executive Member of the International Service for Acquisition of Agri-Biotech Applications, USA, and African Biosafety Network, Burkina Faso. Sir has did his BSc in Agriculture from Nagpur University in 1961, MSc in Agriculture, Plant Pathology from Nagpur University in 1967, PhD in Plant Pathology, with gold medal from IRI New Delhi in 1972, postdoc from the University of Hohenheim Stuttgart in 1982 and 1986, DSc from the Rajendra Agriculture University Bihar in 2009. Sir has commenced his career in plant pathology research at IRI and worked in various capacities in Central Rice Research Institute Cuttack, Punjab Agriculture University PAU Ludhiana, Maharashtra Agriculture University MAU Parbhani for nearly 30 years. The research, teaching and extension experience led him to work as a Vice Chancellor of the MAU Parbhani, Director, Central Institute of Cotton Research Nagpur and Agriculture Commissioner, Government of India, New Delhi before retiring as a Chairman of the Agriculture Scientist Recruitment Board, Minister of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, Government of India. Though specialized in plant pathology, Dr. Mai sir committed himself for the growth of the Indian agriculture. In plant pathology, he guided 20 PhD and more than 38 MSc students. He wrote books, monographs, published over 200 scientific publications in journals of the national and international repute. During his scientific career, Dr. Mai sir promoted the production technologies of cotton, groundnut, sunflower, coarse cereals, and always remain active in the sports, games, cultural activities, and helping students in placement. Also, Mai sir visited many foreign countries like USA, UK, Malaysia, Philippines, South Africa, Canada, Brazil, and many more. And these visits were made by sir on the invitation of government or professional organizations. Sir has received many awards right from the start of his career, such as Merit Scholars in Graduate Studies, ICF Senior Fellow for PhD Studies, Best Seminar Student Award, Sant Bala Roy Chowdhury Gold Medal for the highest CGPA at IRI New Delhi, Professional MS Narasimhan Academic Award by IPS New Delhi in 1974, Pesticide Award by ISMOP Udaipur, Silver Jubilee Honor for Contribution of the Oilseed Research by DOR Hyderabad in 1993, Vasantrao Naik Krishi Award in 2002 for Outstanding Team Research Award in 2003, Dr. B. Vishwanath Award in 2005 for outstanding contribution to Indian agriculture in general and plant pathology in particular. Lifetime Achievement Award by Doctors Agri and Horticulture Development Society Lucknow and many more awards. So today we are very fortunate to have Dr. C.D. Mai sir as a chief guest of the today's event. A very, very warm welcome to you, sir. Also, we are honored to have with us Dr. M.B. Nagdive sir, Director of Instructions and Dean Agri Engineering, Dr. PDKV Akola, Dr. V.K. Kharche sir, Director of Research, Dr. PDKV Akola, Dr. D.M. Mankar sir, Director of Extension Education, Dr. PDKV Akola, for this event as a guest of honor. Welcome, sir, to this event. Also, we are blessed to have special presence of the all associate deans, HODs, faculty members of the Dr. PDKV Akola. Welcome, sir, to the ceremony. Once again, I extend my warm welcome to all the participants. Very warm welcome to all of you for this today's event. Productivity is never an accident. It is always the result of commitment to excellence, intelligent planning, and focused effort. Dear participants, if you have attended such a wonderful training program from comfort of your home and office, it is because of the determination and efforts of our convener and program director of this online training, Dr. S.R. Kabande, sir, principal investigator of NAHEP, and registrar Dr. PDKV Akola. I extend my heartily welcome to you, sir, on behalf of the team NAHEP. Another pillar of this program, Dr. V.P. Khambalkar, sir, co-PI NAHEP and organizing secretary of this event. Engineer D.S. Karai, sir, co-PI NAHEP and coordinator of this event, have also joined. Welcome, sir. Success is not key to happiness. Happiness is a key to success. If you love what you are doing, you will be successful. With this note, we move forward in this program. Now I request Dr. S.R. Kabande, sir, PI NAHEP, Dr. PDKV Akola, to give his reflections and remarks about this two-week online training program.
A very good morning to all of you. First of all, I pay my respect to Punjab Rao, Balaji's Bhausaheb Deshmukh. Today we gather here online for this valedictory function of this two-week national e-training on Indian agriculture education system and entrepreneurship scope in 21st century, and which has been scheduled during the August 5 to up to today, 14th of this August 2020. It is my proud privilege to welcome our today's chairman of this program, Honorable Colonel Dr. V.M. Bhale sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor of our university. Today, I am very happy and glad that our Honorable Vice Chancellor has conferred with Colonel Commandant NCC with by National Cadet Corps Amravati Group. So, on behalf of NAHEP and all the participants, all trainees, and all faculty members, I congratulate you, sir, for this for conferring as honorary rank of this Colonel Commandant NCC.
Thank you.
So we all were busy in this program. That's why this program is scheduled after 10 to 15 minutes afterward. Then chief guest of today's function, Dr. C.D. Mai sir. All are known very well about this personality. He is a star in the galaxy. He is a president, board of directors, New Delhi, and former vice chancellor of Vasantrao Naik Marathwada Agriculture University, Parbhani, and former chairman of ESRB, ICR, New Delhi. I also welcome today's guest of honor, Dr. M.B. Nagdive sir, director of instructions and dean agriculture engineering. Dr. V.K. Kharche sir, director of research. Dr. D.M. Mankar sir, director of extension education. All associate dean, head of the departments, dear faculty members, all my NAHEP team, and all my dear participants, trainee participants, I again offer warm welcome to all of you. So this is the NAHEP project, National Agriculture Higher Education Project, which is sanctioned under innovation grant by ICAR and which is partly funded by World Bank on the capacity building and skill development in renewable energy. And under this program, the main objective is the entrepreneurship development, skill development among the students as well as in the faculty. And many programs we organize under this NAHEP project in our university. And because of this NAHEP project, our university has got a recognition at National as well as international level. So many programs of personality development for the students, then for the faculty members have been organized. And today we are gathered here for this valedictory function of this 2-week training program. And this program was started on 4th of this August. And I will give a brief about this program. So this program was started on 4th of this August, and it was inaugurated by Honorable Vice Chancellor MPUET, Maharana Pratap University of Agriculture and Technology, Udaipur, Dr. N.S. Rathod sir. Then Dr. R.B. Sharma sir, he was the guest of honor. He is National Coordinator of NAGP. Dr. V.M. Bhale sir, he was the chairman of that function. Then Dr. Indramani Mishra, President ISE, Indian Society of Agriculture Engineering. He was also the guest of honor of that program. And during the inaugural session, Dr. N.S. Rathod sir, he has highlighted the national quality, the national policy of this education system. And he elaborated the 3T, which is the type of governing system, that is the timely action, trouble-free approach, and transparency in his inaugural speech. Also, Dr. V.M. Bhale sir, he has expressed his views, and he told that the next revolution is only because of this agriculture, technology, and engineering. And from education, we need such implement. He expressed the view, his view, that we need the implements. How mechanically the cost of that harvesting will be reduced? Such instruments and equipments are required. And he also focused on the various activities of this skill development in the university. And for this training program, we have received very good response from all the corners of our India. We received 1,126 registration from all over the India. And out of this, all these more than 1,000 participants daily, in between 400 to 500 trainee participants, they have attended this training. And in all these participants are faculties and research staff of the state agriculture universities, then KVK, research organizations across India. Among all participants, 25% of these participants are from our home university, Dr. PDKV Akola, 7% from MPKV Rahuri, then 4% from VNMKV Parbhani, 2% from Dapoli, and remaining 62% are from the rest of Maharashtra, out of which 25% participants are female participants and 75% are male participants, which includes the assistant professor, associate professor, professor, principal scientist, research associate, SRF, JRF, and young professional. And the main objective of that of this training is to develop the skill of this faculty, then improve the teaching system and develop entrepreneurship ecosystem in our Indian agriculture education system. For that purpose, we invited 17 guest speakers, which includes our in-house scientist from renowned institutes, also from the renowned institutes across India, such as NAM Hyderabad, then State Agriculture University of the Gujarat, then Central Agriculture University Gangtok, and some are from the ICER side, director of the ICER. Some private professionals are also invited. And every day, we arrange two sessions, one session in the morning and another session in the afternoon hours. And all the participants, they actively participated in this training program. In the first day, Dr. K.H. Rao, he's principal scientist from NAM. He has delivered his lecture on the educational technology. Then Dr. Ranjit Kumar, he's also from NAM. He has given his lecture on the introduction to business plan and goal setting. Then Dr. M.B. Nagdeve, our director of instructions and dean, he has also given his lecture on the role of this agri-entrepreneurship and farming innovations for the youth. Then Mrs. Radha Shankar Narayanan, CEO of Smart Cities Bangalore. She has delivered his lecture on the current and emerging trends in adult learning. Then Dr. Sanju Kumar from NAM Hyderabad, myself, then Dr. Mahendra Sevda from College of Agriculture Engineering, Gangtok, Sikkim. Dr. V. Mageshwaram, Senior Scientist from ICR, National Bureau of Agriculturally Important Microorganisms, UP, Mahu, UP. Then R.F. Sutar from Anand. Dr. S.K. Srivastava, Director Acting, ICR Central for Women Agriculture, Indian Agriculture Research, Bhuneshwar. Dr. S.D. Gorantiwar, then Dr. K.J. Kambre, Dr. Mukesh Asar, Mr. Manish Patil, and today, Dr. C.D. Meiser, President Board of Director, South Asia Biotechnology Center. He has delivered his very lecture, very important and wonderful lecture. All the participants, I received the feedback from most of the participants. The feedback is very good. And Dr. Meiser has discussed various issues on the biotechnology, food habits, the nutritional security, then agriculture revolution. He said that agriculture revolution without using any technology, any advanced technology, there will be no revolution in the agriculture. He also discussed the relevance of biotechnology in the present scenario. Then bio-based fuels, new breeding techniques, all the issues are discussed by Dr. Meiser. So thank you very much, sir, for your interactive lecture. So this we organized this e-training program on the Zoom platform. And also at the same time, we arranged this live session, broadcasting of this live session on the YouTube channel also. And every day, 400 to 415 participants, they have participated and they have attended this training program on the Zoom platform. And the remaining participants, they attended their program on the YouTube channel. So all the sessions are very interactive. Questions from both the platforms were answered by the expert during this training session. And we also recorded the attendance of each and every participants. And all these participants will receive their training certificate after 15 days because the number of participants are very more. And since last 10 days, my NHEP team and all these guest faculties, they are working together for the success of this e-training program. And they are working in a team, not in a group. So it is very much important to form the team. And so I am very much thankful to all my team. Also, I am thankful to our Honorable Vice Chancellor, Dr. V.M. Bhale, sir, all the trainee participants, because they are part.
Sir, you are disconnected. Kalbande, sir. Hello. Okay, Kalbande, sir, is disconnected. So we move forward in this program.
Pudcha suru kara, madam.
Yes, sir.
ते डिस्कनेक्ट झाले ते नंतर पाहता येईल.
हा सो आय कॉंग्रॅच्युलेट ऑल द पार्टिसिपंट्स फॉर सक्सेसफुल कम्प्लिशन ऑफ दिस ट्रेनिंग प्रोग्राम. सो आय स्टॉप हियर अँड थँक्यू व्हेरी मच सर.
थँक्यू सर. द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ द टीम इज इन इच इंडिव्हिज्युअल मेंबर. द स्ट्रेंथ ऑफ इच मेंबर इज अ टीम. Dr. M.B. Nagdive, sir, Director of Instructions and Dean Faculty of Agriculture Engineering, Dr. P.D.K.V. Akola, is always a strength of the team in NHEP. I request him to give his guiding remarks to the audience.
Hello. Good morning to all. Sir, first of all, I pay my tribute to Dr. Punjabrao Deshmukh, today's chairman of this valedictorian function, Dr. V.M. Bhale, sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor Dr. Punjabrao Deshmukh, Krishi Vidyapeeth, today's chief guest, our eminent scientist, respected Dr. C.D. Meiser, He is a president of Board of Directors, SABC, and he former chairman of ASRB. And again, he was the vice chancellor of the Western of Nike, Maratha Krishi Vidyapeeth. So I'm really first time in the capacity of director of instruction. I welcome you, sir, for this event. Dr. S.R. Karpande, the PI of National Agriculture Higher Education Project, our NHV team and the participant. This is a great pleasure to me that we have completed successfully the 10 days program on Indian agriculture education system and entrepreneurship scope in 21st century. And this really gives me pleasure to have, as Karpande told, more than 1,000 participants have joined from across the country. Sir, this is actually, as you know, this program, NHP program, is a training program, basically, the component given to the university. And I'm very happy, actually, a lot of eminent scientists, and today also, the Dr. Myser have delivered the lecture during this program. And I really thank all the resource persons who have delivered the lectures out of their busy schedule. About the program, the Dr. Karpande sir has already narrated the things in details. So I don't think I have to repeat that. And I really congratulate all the participants who have attended this. But actually, this attention is not the only, certificate is not the only objective, should not be the objective of this training. They should really become the entrepreneurship, actually, after this training, and they should take help of the experiences of the resource person who have delivered the lectures in this training program. I will be very happy if at least 10%, 10-15% of the trainees and come to me and say that, sir, we have started our business or we have become the entrepreneurship, I think our success is that. So with these two words, I congratulate all the participants to attend the training. And once again, I welcome myself to this program. And thank you with these two words. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Excellent firm don't believe in excellence, but believe in constant improvement and constant change. To improve the performance in the future endeavor, participants' feedback is of great help. So it's time for the participants' feedback. Now I request Dr. Lilimoni Tripathi, Associate Professor of Odisha University of Agriculture and Technology, to share her feelings about this program. Dr. Tripathi, ma'am.
I think she has not presented. Please take next.
Yes. Now I request Dr. Vilas Kumar, sir, scientist of the ICAR NAIP Pusa, New Delhi, to share his views. Dr. Vilas Kumar, sir. He's also not there.
Thank you, madam. Very grateful that you have. You have allowed me to participate in the training. This training has covered all the topics which are required for developing the entrepreneurship of the different categories of the people. Women were there. It is for farmers. It is for ordinary youth. It is for even employed people. So, and very systematic lectures were delivered. And even the people who could not attend the lectures in time, they can see the lecture on the YouTube. So it was a quite a boundary free kind of training, and it has removed the restrictions that were imposed by the coronavirus. Even during this period, it has the organizers have conducted the training, and I am again thankful to the organizer, because Dr. CD Mai sir, because I was selected to the ARS system under the chairmanship of sir, and it was a very punctual, transparent system under the chairmanship of sir. So I'm thankful for and I'm grateful to the organizer for conducting this training.
Yeah, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Now I request Dr. Ranjana Tiwari, ma'am, Assistant Professor of Noida International University, to share her experience. Your voice is not audible, ma'am.
Please unmute.
Ranjana madam, hello. Swati madam, awaaz
nahi. Yes. Hello, Ranjana ma'am, your voice is not audible. Please unmute yourself.
Next, yeah, next.
Okay. So she's her voice is not audible. We'll take next. Now I request Mr. Divesh Vaghela, Assistant Professor of the Parul University, to share his experience. Mr. Divesh Vaghela. Okay, so he's also not there. So thank you, sir. True guidance is like a small torch in the dark forest. It does not show everything at once, but gives enough light for the next step to be set. With this note, we move forward in this program. And now I request the most honorable person of the today's event, Dr. C.D. Mai, sir, President of the South Asia President of the South Asia Biotechnology Center, New Delhi, to give his guiding remarks to the audience.
Thank you, madam. Are you able to hear me?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. So, the chairman of today's valedictory program, Dr. V.M. Bhale, the Vice Chancellor of PDKV Akola, guest of honor for today is Dr. Nagdive, who has recently become Dean Agriculture and Director of Instructions and also Dean Faculty of Engineering. Dr. Kharche, Director of Research, Mankar, Director of Extension. I am happy that Dr. Kalbande, who is the in charge of this and is registrar and also PI of this program, all associate deans, all heads of the department, of the faculties, NAHEP team, my dear students, all trainees and friends. I think I am very happy to be amongst you for this particular program of India's agriculture education system and entrepreneurship scope in 21st century. And this is through what we call it as e-training. Now, this is what is going to happen. The entire education is going to be more digitalized, I think, in the 21st century. So we are very happy that you have started in this corona pandemic period a program which is basically e-learning. Today we are connected to also almost for entire 2 weeks through this e-training program. And I am happy that Dr. Punjab Rao Deshmukh Krishi Vidyapeeth Akola has really taken the lead in this, and they have successfully conducted this program of agriculture education system and entrepreneurship scope. I was a little surprised that there were about 1126 something participants which were selected for this. It's a good thing, but I think you have kept it open and many more must have already enjoyed this program. Our country has, let me tell you, enough infrastructure for agriculture education. Probably you are all aware that there are 74 plus agriculture universities in the country. I think it was 73 plus or 74, something like that. I don't exactly remember now. But I think every state has now more than one. You have also subject-oriented universities like veterinary university, fisheries university, horticulture universities. So as the scope increases now, I wish there would be agriculture engineering. I think I am sure that Nagdive will be hearing it. There may be agriculture engineering universities in future. and there is a wide scope. So your agriculture is divided now both ways. It could be regional wise, as we have in Maharashtra. We have Vidarbha region, Marathwada region, maybe like UP. You have several regions. So regional agriculture universities and also subject-wise universities. So I think it's a big mix now. 73, 74 agriculture universities is a very big scope. And simultaneously, it is supported by what is called as a NAR system, National Agricultural Research System. Now, National Agriculture Research System is equal to SAUs, all SAUs plus ICAR institutes. So it's a huge system. And you know, with 74 universities, what is the infrastructure of ICAR? One of the largest in the world, 103 institutions in the country. You name any product, you name any commodity, you have an institute. Maybe it is yak, maybe it is unt, where we call camel, or maybe it is fish, which is cold water, or maybe fish, which is marine water, which is brackish water. You have all crops, maybe it is onion, chili, or anything. You have institute practically on everything in this country. Nowhere in the world, I think, this kind of infrastructure exists. And we must complement ICAR. It is not only the major institutes, but we have also what is called as a regional institute. Like Cotton Institute has a region in Shirsa, Haryana, for North Zone. And there is a South Zone, Coimbatore. So we have also likewise nearly 100 plus regional stations under ICAR working to support agriculture universities. And we have also what we call it as coordinated projects. Wonderful system. I think there are more than 75 all India coordinated projects, which are with the what we call it in the universities. And there is a big link. Nowhere you will find that there is a, although state universities has a lot of influence of state government. But technically, I am happy that SAUs are totally linked to ICAR. And for educational program, they are being supported heavily by ICAR through the education department and accreditation board and all those things. It's a very big situation. Also, I must add that we have also 5 to 6 bureaus. There is a bureau on soil science, a bureau on insect, bureau on fungi, bacteria, virus, microbes. There is a bureau on plant genetic resources, animal genetic resources, fish genetic resources. So you can imagine that this network, I think we must thank all our predecessors, including Dr. Paroda and Dr. Chopra and Swaminathan and all those who have contributed significantly to this network program. That's why we call it as NARS. So in all, if you see, there are more than 30,000 teachers in the country who are involved in SAUs and also in the ICAR scientists. So teachers come scientists. And this is one organization which has always three jobs: teaching, research, and extension. That's why you will find that there is a very close network of farmers also with the universities. And this kind of infrastructure is going to be one of the most diversified, which you will not find in any educational system. I think that's why I say that agriculture university system is really one of the most strongest. And the involvement of talented students in agriculture sector will help improving now the quality of trained human resources. Now I am only concerned that the quality of education has to improve a lot. And we have to innovate a lot of new ideas, and they must be diversified into all these pictures. Now there are massive opportunities of entrepreneurship. I was surprised the other day, I read one lady preparing jawar rotis every day. She prepares thousands of rotis, packs them in a 5-pack and sell it at 25 rupees a pack. Can you imagine? We have several now FPOs which are doing excellent jobs. So entrepreneurship development, if you see, and that too with youngsters, there is a place called as Sonai, where few young students, they have joined hands with the farmers to grow a cycle of vegetables throughout the year. And they take it to the early morning in the market of Bombay. That's called as a Sonai model. Fantastic ways now the students are coming in agriculture sector and they are now being trained. Now, in this training program, there are 13 eminent speakers. I don't know how much each of them, how much I could contribute to them. But I think I tried to show you what is the scope of biotechnology today. If we make interpretation, there are young scientists who can develop tissue culture labs. And tissue culture itself can be a big sale, like what is happening in banana, sugarcane. It can be in tick, it can be in bamboo. Endless. Biofertilizer production. I was happy that where I am sitting, the biofertilizers and biopesticide being sold in this period of your pandemic is more than how many lakhs?
6 lakhs.
6 lakhs they have sold. And the Parbhani, I think I was told that it is crossing 1 crore. So we need to really expand now. We have to create entrepreneurship to do all those things. So the national e-training program will be helpful to enhance the skill. And that is more important. I think the new education policy, if you have read, the most important part of the policy, general policy, 5+3+3+4, I think the most important part is skill orientation. Once you have 5 years basic knowledge, then it is all will be in the skill. And I think we'll have a time has come now in agriculture, we'll have to change our system. Let us start talking about practicals first. And then theory teaching. I think that is what is required. The first 2 years of agriculture must be in your with the cows, with the harrows, with the plows, with the tractors, with the machinery. And then teach them what is the basic science of them. I am personally congratulate NAHEP team for providing e-platform to undergo 2-week national training program. And I give best wishes to the participants of this faculty. I appreciate Dr. Kalbande being PI of his team and his all efforts who managed very well. And I am happy to see him in full suit today. I think what a PI requires is a suit today. And that with tie and suit, with all these, what we call it as high temperature, is something which I really appreciate, Dr. Kalbande, that you have started online e-training program for the faculty. Let us now start at university level, at each university level, something like E, where we should engage our students, where we are not able to start colleges through this program. So with these few words, once again thanking all the team, both at maybe at Bhuneshwar, maybe at Delhi, and everywhere that you have invited me for this valedictory function. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable guidance. And now I request today's chairman, Honorable Dr. V.M. Bhale, sir, Vice Chancellor Dr. P.D.K.V. Akola, to address the gathering.
Hello. It's audible, Swati?
Yes, sir, you are audible, sir.
Okay. Good morning. Respected Dr. C.D. Mai, sir, chief guest of today's valedictory function. The organizer of this 2-week program, Dr. Kalbande and his team. At outset, I must congratulate Dr. Kalbande and his team for organizing this wonderful 2-week program on Indian agriculture education system, entrepreneurship scopes in the 21st century. I hope that the deliberation during this period was effective and the student might have enriched with this knowledge how to develop the entrepreneurs. In fact, at the beginning only I told that there is a scope in the as such in the agriculture, as you know that endemic 19. This all the industries were stopped. And only the industry of agriculture was running in this 4-month period globally. And the same thing with this Maharashtra and national level. Now this has also given the avenues. What are the agro-based industries the graduate, non-agriculture graduate also can do. And this has given open an avenue to work in the farming community, to process the farming produce and to sell in the market, to develop a linkage at the district level, the linkage at state level, linkage globally also. The only thing that you should, heartily, you should work in the agriculture field and let us in touch with this, what are the produce is being produced by the farmer, how they may get, how they will give these premium prices. So there are a lot of things in the agriculture entrepreneur as such. Any graduate, even non-agriculture, can also work in industry as such. Friends, as you know that in the 4 month period, the only produce which to be used for our livelihood since morning to evening, whatever the food, all are coming from the agriculture itself. But now if you see the condition of the farming community, still it is not to that level. And this is only because of the premium prices farmer could not get, and they are not being educated to process the food. And these entrepreneurs, which we have learned in the 2 week period, definitely will not only earn the money, not establish your business, but which can also provide the premium prices to the farming community, which can also give the healthy food to the large populations. As we know that organic food, it's good for health, and even globally, the COVID-19 has more damage in the European countries, even US also, though they do have the very good facilities of medicine, very good hygienic conditions, their livelihood is itself is very high standard, but still in Indian conditions, we cannot compare like that, but still our immunity is more compared to these people, and the as such, the progress for the COVID-19, our people, they have survived. It is only because of the food habit, the variety of food we are taking. But unfortunately, whatever the produce which has not been processed, and there is a large avenues to process this food and to have the market in the European countries and even including the USA. My friends, there are the malls are being opened in the district, in the more in the cities. Every district would have the one or two mall. And in that mall, you will find that some of the agriculture produce has been sold. It's a good business that if you bring together maybe 100 family, whatever possible for you, more than 1,000 family, a scattered sowing of this vegetable will provide a good business than harvesting, cleaning, packing, separating, and marketing. Only vegetable can give a good entrepreneurs, which can be sold in the city, which can be sold in the village also itself. Now people, they are educated to take hygienic food. So in agriculture, every product, we have the lot of entrepreneurs can be work in this agriculture field as an industry. And we can establish industry even village level, from village up to block level, district level, regional level, and for the export oriented business can be set up. As such, you know that in Vidarbha, this citrus, we know that Nagpur city is made as a citrus, but how much citrus is being processed? We know that onion being a problem, now cotton is a problem, it has not been sold in the market. So these produce need the processing. Even the millet having the very high value, they may supply the minerals, they may supply the vitamins, which is not being available in the non-veg food, but our vegetarian food will provide that. So the millet, how much area is being covered there, millet? Can you go for the increasing area of the millet? Can you process that millet? Can you provide this food, hygienic food, nutritious food for the large populations? And engineering faculty as such, Dr. Kanbhai is in his team, has done a lot of work. Though he is having the two projects, the NIA project, under this project, we have provided a lot of facilities, even offline in presence also. Last year, 2019, workshop in seminar was organized, and even this year in pandemic period also, online were organized many seminar and training, entrepreneurship development training. So I think, Any knowledge has been required, the university is at the door to help you to establish this business. And I hope that definitely, if you look in the very seriously, I don't think you need any service. You will not search any service provided. If you gain in knowledge, which industries we can establish, maybe starts from the small to the large area to the global area. Within a short period, we can gain a good, we can establish a good industries. So friends, with these few words, I appeal and I request to participants, those who have been taken benefited for this 2-week program for the development entrepreneurship, any help required, university is ready to help you to how to establish what type of business can be established. So with these few words, I thanks Dr. Maisa, your valuable guidance, definitely all the time inspiring for us. Today's topic was also good, agriculture biotechnology. There is a scope for this subject, agriculture biotechnology. As such, we do have the one college at Yavatmal, and good students have been admitted. They are also absorbed. Almost 3-4 batches are absorbed in different food industries. So with these few words, thank you very much and best luck. I compliments to the Calvin and his team very constantly. They are organizing this program, online program, which will benefit the students from maybe from even other states and even abroad also. So with these words, thank you very much and best luck.
Thank you, sir, for your valuable guidance and appreciation. Talent and skills are the crops that are nurtured, groomed, and given all possible opportunities to grow and bloom. This event, as it gives the returns to the efforts put in by the participants throughout their 2-week journey. It is a moment full of joy, a moment about pride and accomplishment, a moment of celebration. It gives sense of achievement and sense of responsibility towards fulfilling further commitments. It fills the heart with mixed feelings, fulfillment, anxiety, and eagerness. It's time for e-certificate distribution. Since it is a digital program, we are displaying 5 certificates of selective participants on the screen. All the participants will receive their certificates later on. Now I request Engineer Sahu to display the certificate one by one on the screen. So first certificate goes to Dr. Vilas Kumar, scientist of ICAR NAIP New Delhi. Congratulations, sir. So next one, another certificate goes to Dr. Lily Moni Tripathi, Associate Professor of Odisha University of Agriculture and Technology. Congratulations, ma'am. Next certificate goes to Dr. Raju L. Chavan, Associate Professor of COH Odisha. Congratulations, sir. Next certificate goes to Dr. M.M. Deshmukh, sir, Associate Professor of Dr. P.D.K.V. Akola. Congratulations, sir. So thank you, Sahu. And congratulations to all participants for successful completion of this training, online training program. Gratitude is the fairest blossom which springs from the soul. As we come to the closure of our valedictory ceremony, I invite Dr. V.P. Khambalkar, sir, co-PI NAGP, Dr. P.D.K.V. Akola, to propose the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Swami. I am very much thankful to the ICAR for providing the opportunity to our university to act as a mediator for conducting the such online training program for the faculties, for the students. So on behalf of the PDKV, I am very much thankful to the ICAR and the NDs and national coordinators for helping and providing the guidance in respect of conducting the training. I am very much thankful to today's chief guest, Dr. C.D. Mai, sir, who has also contributed his expert lectures, and the lecture is very innovative. Definitely the participants have got benefited, and thanks for the thanks being a part of this valedictory program of the 2-week national training. Thank you, sir. I am very much thankful to today's chairman, Dr. V.M. Bhale, sir, honorable vice chancellor, Dr. P.D.K. Akola. Dr. Bhale, sir is always increase our motivation and has guided in many way to fulfill the NAGP objective. Thank you, sir, for being a part of NAGP at every stage. Thank you, sir. I am very much thankful to our dean and director of instruction, Dr. M.B. Nagdive, sir. Sir has a vital platform to achieve our goals, and in many ways, sir has supported to the events. Thank you, sir, for the motivational as well as the road to bring the roadmap of NHP at Dr. BD. Thank you, sir. I'm very much thankful to our PI, Dr. S.R. Carpenter, sir. Sir has a unique ideas to develop the various program, and in many ways, sir shot out the program and fulfill the requirement of the students and the faculty. So sir is always looking at the benefits of the faculty and students in many ways, and his innovative ideas creates the our platform that we can contribute to the nations by bringing the trainings and workshop in a e-platform. Thank you, sir, for being a part of NHP at Dr. Pitti Kukula. I am very much thankful to the all participants who have actually involved in 2-week program. So I am also thankful to them, and and again, I am very much thankful to the our team who is continuously coordinating the program in many ways, so that the faculties cannot miss the any single events, single lectures from from their schedule. So thank you to the all the team. Thank you to all of you.
Thank you, sir. The end of the story is new beginning for many others. On this note, let's conclude a remarkable and memorable valedictory session. Thank you, everyone. Have a great day ahead, and wish you all the very best for your future. Stay happy, stay safe, and stay connected with us for our upcoming events. Thank you. Thank you,
everyone. Thank you.